Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon.
Thank you very much. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Buon Esso a Sifu.
Amen.
Mi stai dicendo Buon Esso a Sifu.
Amen.
Thank you very much for coming. The number might be quite small, but we understand that people travel, and we appreciate that this time now, unlike last year, we don't have lockdown, so people can travel and join up with their family and relatives. We appreciate that. Amen.
Amen.
Today, I pray that we learn through the wisdom that comes from God. And just as we grow as Christians, as we grow in our Christian lives, the wisdom of the Lord becomes part of us, and that will grow in that wisdom of the Lord. Friends, we get this from 1 Corinthians chapter 2. But then, there is no doubt that our perception of Christ influences our relationship to God and to one another and how we live our entire lives. We have different perceptions of Christ within the believing church as well as those who don't believe. He is to some the Son of God, and to others he is the Son of Man. To others he is a good example worth emulating. But then some see him as a very influential man and a miracle worker, and others think that the success in the name of Jesus. To the Muslims, he is one of God's prophets, one who brings scripture, a worker of miracles, and the Messiah. We have a certain cult in East Africa that is called the Legio Maria. According to them, they believe that Jesus is the white Messiah, and he was sent to the white people, while their very own Simeon Legio is the black Messiah sent to the blacks. But then closer home, we have a certain sect, allow me to call it sect, in Kitui, and the larger part of Mwingi, called the Kavonocha. According to them, Jesus Christ is a miracle-working God and a great physician, and therefore there is no need for them to seek any medical attention. This list is endless. But the question remains for you and for me: who is Jesus Christ? And according to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Jesus Christ is the transforming power and the wisdom of God. Praise the Lord. He is the transforming power and the wisdom of God. You see, human power and wisdom, they have a way of distorting and destroying the gospel message. Human power and wisdom distort and destroy the gospel. Paul says in verse 3, When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or superior wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. I came to you in weakness. As I came to you, I came to you in weakness. You see, when Paul writes to the Corinthians, especially the first two chapters, there is evidence of tension between human power and the wisdom that comes from the Lord. Human power, human wisdom, God's power, and God's wisdom. He says in chapter 2 that his proclamation did not rest on eloquence or human wisdom. You see a bit of history here. The city of Corinth was well known for producing people who are very good with words. You know? People who were very good when it comes to putting words together. In fact, they were all very good orators. You know? But then he says this proclamation did not rest on eloquence or human wisdom. Friends, this city of Corinth was famous for great learning and philosophy. And this city produced great debaters and great philosophers. And these men treated with disgust and disrespect anything that was not palatable or appealing to their intellectual curiosity. And so, Paul did not have the smooth flow of fine words. Then he was not a great public speaker. But then he says, I came to you, brothers, in meekness, in humility. But then the debaters were the movie stars of the day. And public speaking was the primary source of entertainment. You had to be good. If you were supposed to attract people to yourself, then you had to be good. And so the three main components of public speaking included the audience, which was a given. People used to come and listen to this great orator. And then the second component was the message, which was dependent, variable. It depended on the debaters. And then the third thing was the results, which were independent, variable. And so the message was the most important part that the speaker had to work on. And so given such standards according to them, Paul was an embarrassment to the Corinthians. He did not even meet that criterion. But then, just like the city of Athens as portrayed in Acts chapter 12, verse 17, Athens was well known as the eye of Greece. And this was also known as the mother and the art of eloquence. Because in this city, four great people came out of this city. Follow me, King. The greatest philosopher who ever lived walked in the streets of Athens. His name was Socrates. And his best student was Plato. And Plato's best student was Aristotle. And Aristotle's best student was Alexander the Great. And all of these men lived and walked in the streets of Athens. And so just like Athens, the city of Corinth was greatly defined by smooth flow of words. And then Paul says that he did not spend time in Corinth delivering mentally appealing sermons with logical and well-knit ideas. He says his manner of proclamation failed the standards of the prevailing oratory and philosophy. But then consequently, the content of his proclamation did not measure up to the prevailing standards of earthly wisdom. And so Paul encourages us to stay on the messenger's calling, not on persuasion, to preach Christ and him crucified, whether people like it or not. Then he says, according to him, the audience is also given, but the message is constant. We are told that he is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. May the name of the Lord be blessed. And then these philosophers, they consider the gospel foolishness and very irrelevant. In fact, verse 3 says, I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. Paul was nervous and he was shaky. He states that Jews demand signs, something to prove one's power, something that even us today we are going after. You know, we have been in this church, we have been in this system for a very long time, and we know how God works. But if someone comes out there and he pitches his tent by the gate, and then he says that there are some miracles here, trust me, a couple of us will go and see. You know, these miracles, even when we know the truth. These people demanded signs, but then Paul did not impress them. In fact, their mocking observation is, they say that his letters are heavy and very forceful, but Paul in person is quite unimpressive. And so scholars say that Paul, even in his weakness, the power of the Lord was evident in his life. And that is what matters. As much as that might hold a lot of water, him not being appealing, the power of the Holy Spirit rested upon him. And then Paul says that I want to be known as a very humble servant of the Lord. We must realize that when Paul says that lest the cross of Christ be emptied, it does not mean that at any point the cross will lose its power. You as a Christian might be mocked. You as a Christian might pray for someone and they might die and not get well. That does not mean that the power of cross is not there. But as was you. Because when human ability is given precedence in the service of Christ, such service is less transformative and more destructive to the kingdom agenda. So you see, today, more than ever before, we are facing a well-designed and well-deliberate distortion and destruction of the gospel. The gospel message has been compromised for the sake of relevance, for the sake of tolerance and peaceful coexistence. Let us think about relevance for a moment. You see, in your capacity, in everything that you do, we know that you have to be relevant. As a teacher, as a business person, one must operate from a point of information, and that is well taken into account. But we must understand that we should be relevant as messengers and custodians of biblical principles. Relevance is not compromise. It is faithfulness to the gospel message. It is not commitment to the things, the traditions that we know, but it is a true commitment of the content of our love that Christ has called us to. You see, friends, one of the greatest challenges that we face as Christians is proclaiming the constant and the unchanging gospel to a world that is ever evolving. We keep on using the same strategies and the same plans, and they've been failing because we should understand the gospel does not change, but you and I change. See, I'm reminded of a story in Kakuma of this Sudanese who's asking for direction. And he's asking an elderly woman, and this Sudanese is speaking English, and this lady does not understand. And then the lady, says in a language that she does not understand what he's saying. And this Sudanese, for a moment, thinks that he is not loud enough. And he shouts, And by shouting, he hopes that the woman will understand what he's saying. Friends, so often than not, the shouting and voice projection can never be a substitute for true content and love. Whether you shout, whether you shout or not, that can never be a substitute for true love and content that comes from the Lord. The test of relevance is not the projection of my voice or the weight of applause we receive from people, but God's approval of what we are doing this day. Does the Lord approve what we are doing? See, you might be aware that it is increasingly becoming difficult to preach about sin and salvation. Sermons that rebuke are no longer welcome. And so often than not, they're termed as the pastors of preparedness. Earthly wisdom has taught believers how to play the game of pretense, whereby we have mastered the art of greeting one another with the fist and not with the heart. We have mastered the art of smiling with the teeth and not with the heart. You meet someone and tell them, it was really nice getting to meet you today. But in essence, what you mean is that now I really got bored. We have mastered the art of saying things from the face value, but we really don't mean them. You bid someone goodbye, and you tell them, we'll see you this Christmas, I'll see you another time. But in essence, what you mean, brother, good riddance. You see, woe unto us if we love the world and embrace the values that it gives. Whenever we do, and whatever we do here in church, should be in line with the guiding principles that the Lord has given us. Let us not seek to build names for ourselves. This is all after wisdom, and it will not take us anywhere. Brothers and sisters, Paul says, human power and wisdom, they have a way of distorting and destroying the gospel. And then he tells us, Christian faith needs the power and the wisdom of God for its stability and sustenance. He says in verse 2, I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Christ and Him crucified. Jesus Christ and His message and His crucifixion were at the center of Paul's message. Chapter 1, verse 23, Paul says, but then we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those that God has called, both Jews and the Greeks, Christ is the power of God, and Christ is the power of God and the resurrection of God. Friends, to him, Christ was the center of everything. And that is my encouragement to you, and that is my encouragement to me today. That whatever you do, whatever area that you hold at, let it be for some reason to bring the glory and honor to God. What I specifically remember the song that we sing at the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I am happy all day. Friends, if you put this thing we call faith into test, so often than not, it looks very stupid and very foolish. But then it is in the acceptance that God is able to do that He demonstrates His power. I have been in this for some time, and I remember one day I was so much convinced in my heart that I was going to pray for someone and they were going to get well. And they were just admitted here in 2016, here in Bishop Hill. And just as the word of God said, filled by the Holy Spirit of God, praise the Lord, I went there. And I was so sure that I was going to pray for this fellow, and they were going to be okay, because there's power in the name of Jesus. And so I went there, and I prayed for them. And a few minutes after praying for them, and then content of my prayer was for them to get well. But then a few minutes after praying for them, they died. You know? And one of these sons there who is not so much into church, he said, we want to see that pastor. He should tell us what he has told God or what he has done to our father, because he was okay before he came. But then, if the Lord decides to heal and give you life back, glory and honor to His name. If the Lord decides to heal you completely and put you to rest, glory and honor to His name. Because He says He emptied Himself of all but love. And it is because of love that He was willing to bore our shame and our guilt. The righteous died for the unrighteous. The Bible tells us that God demonstrated His own love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. There is no greater knowledge than the knowledge of Christ, who humbly came to free us from the bondage of sin and to usher us into this everlasting grace. Friends, as I finish, the cross of God should remind us of the gravity of our sins and the surpassing love and the grace of God. We are now saved by faith in Christ, and our hearts should overflow with joy and gratitude. It's my prayer that God is going to grant us a fresh vision of Christ as a transforming power in the wisdom and the knowledge of God. He suffered for us and He died for us, so that we may be counted righteous before Him. Friends, I have seen a lot of emerging trends and emerging issues that seem to excite some of us. This wealth and health kind of gospel that keeps on moving, you know, tossing up us up and down. But if we truly understood what Philippians chapter 2 verse 6 says, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. And then he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that in the name of Jesus every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth. And when you push it a bit further in the Hebrew, it says, and they will proclaim Hosanna. Every knee will bow and they will proclaim Hosanna, that He is a powerful one. Friends, we have been given this power. He reigns in us. He lives within us. And we do not need all this drama and all these theatrics. We need to understand that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if I pray unto Him, He listens to me. When you pray unto Him, He listens to you. He listens to your prayers. And He grants us our desires. As we celebrate this Christmas, it is my prayer that we will not get distorted by the drama and the theatrics going around, but we remain true and grounded in the name of the Lord. When I say to you, that the cross will remain to be our shield and our defense, that the cross of Christ will always make a way for us. We will stand and share the praise. Our Father, our God, we thank you because it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you for speaking to us today. Thank you for encouraging us today. Thank you for helping us to seek your wisdom and not after wisdom. Help us, Jehovah God, not to be caught up in the mix, but Jehovah God, to rely on us every hour, to trust in you and to love you. May this festive season bring joy to our hearts and a remembrance that a gift of hope was born unto us. I pray for these dear ones. May your grace be sufficient for them. May you bless them, may you watch over them. And even as we look forward to the end of the year, our hearts are filled with joy because it's taken your hand. Lord, as we usher in and embrace a new year, we pray, everlasting Father, that is going to bring good tidings. Blessed be your name. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. May the Lord be with you, and may your team enjoy your Merry Christmas.
I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come.